Welcome everybody for this day of lectures. So we'll start today with the first lecture by Amos Maritain, who I have the pleasure to introduce. Amos Maritain is a professor at the physics department of the University of Padova. And his research interests are very broad, and he had important contributions in several topics of quantitative biology, from the theory of biopolymers to ecology. And in this lecture, he's going to talk about scaling in ecology and the relation between metabolic theory and community patterns. So before Amo starts with the presentation, just a few reminders on how to ask questions. So if you are watching from YouTube, you can post your question in the chat. If you are connected in Zoom, you can either write the question in the chat or use the raise hand tool of Zoom. So thank you, Amo, for being with us, and please start when you are ready.
Thank you, Jacopo, for the introduction. So this is the first lecture of a series of three. The first is delivered by me, by myself. The second will be delivered by Samir Soubeis, and the third by Sandro Azzaire. I think that the order is should be correct. Of course, there are what I will be telling you is the result of a long collaboration, and there is a list, a partial list of at least of the ones that have contributed more to the ideas that I will tell you today. And in particular, Chayan Banova, which is one of my first collaborators, and then Andrea Rinaldo also, that was lecturing in this series of lectures, and Stephen Hubble, that was introducing us to the ecology of forests, that will be most of this lecture will be devoted to them. So, in the last 40 years, there's been a lot of data from bacteria to forest about in ecology, and that at least there are two mainstream approach to them. One, there is a mistake here. This is a model-dependent approach on the left, a model-independent approach on the right. So the model-dependent approach in the left includes a neutral theory, which something will be said by Sandro Azzaele about this in the third lecture, and the resource competition model, which will be the subject of the second lecture. Then the Locke-Volterra equation, kind of equation, that I think that Stefano Lesina has illuminated you on this issue. And then on the right, there is the model-independent approach, which includes the scaling approach that will be illustrated in this lecture. And all of these should converge to some model that contains the scaling embedded in them, in order to be able to reproduce the known results in all ecosystems. Let's say on the most important ecosystem of interest, and of course to be able to be also predictive and not just the descriptive. Okay, so the first thing that I need to be sure that you are aware of is what are power law and how there are deviations from them, in order not to be confused about them. So one example that most of you should know, it is the problem of diffusion, for example, in 1D. And so you have a particle that diffuses in 1D and can move in a symmetric way, both to the right and to the left. And so the probability to be at some position x at time t is given by a Gaussian with a variance that is proportional to the time. And so if you set x equals zero and you ask what is the probability to be at the origin at time t, this is just a power law. And so in 1D, it is a t to the minus one half, and then due to dimensional reason, there is also the diffusion constant that appears in the denominator to the power 1/2, which gives the correct dimension to the probability, which is 1/L, because it is a probability density in 1D. So if we plot this function in a linear plot, we get the plot in the left, which is like similar to an hyperbola. But in order to visualize better the power law, it is convenient to plot the logarithm of P versus the logarithm of T. And so if we plot the log of P versus log of T, we get a straight line with slope minus 1/2. So this is the one on the right, is the best way to visualize when a power law is present in our problem. So typically, what we find is not a pure power law like this, but power law that are a little bit, let's say, dirty or truncated. And the truncation can, the reason for the truncation can be, at least there are two kinds of truncation. One, it is because in the problem, it has been introduced a new time scale. In the previous, there was no time scale. You see that the only time scale is just the time, and there is no characteristic time scale in the problem, and this is why we see a pure power law. If, for example, in the random walk, the diffusion problem, there is an external field that tries to push the particle more to the right than to the left, then there is a time scale in the problem that enters through a sort of average velocity, which is tau, which is 4D, the diffusion constant, time V square, where V square is a sort of average velocity, and so this is the right dimension of time. And so the previous law is corrected by an exponential. So for time much less than tau, we see the previous power law with slope minus 1/2, which is just the prefactor. Whereas for time of order of tau, much larger than tau, we see that the power law is ruined due to a fast decay towards zero. And where the crossover from pure power law to a truncated power law occurs is just the characteristic time scale that has been introduced thanks to the external field. So other reason for having truncated the power law is that the system is finite, for example. So if we have that the particle is contained in some in a fixed region, in a compact region, then there are correction due to the finite size of the system. And these are the ones that will be encountering in this lecture. So there is a problem about the previous two slides where you are encouraged to solve it. It starts from just to describing the movement of a particle in terms of discrete time and spatial steps. And in order to be led to the diffusion equation in 1D, which is 0.5, and then a solution through the Fourier transform, which is the last but one line, where you see that if we set x equals 0, we get exactly what I said in the previous slide about the truncated power law. So even without knowing anything about the exact solution of the diffusion problem in 1D, you could have argued something based on scaling argument. The scaling argument works as this slide show. So if we have to calculate the probability density to be at position x at time t, given that there is a diffusion constant d and there is no bias, no external field at the moment, the diffusion constant has a dimension of length squared divided by time, because it describes how the variance of the position varies with time. It is d times time, and so d is the dimension of length squared divided by time. So since Px of t in d dimension must have the dimension of 1/volume, one way to construct the dimension of volume is just multiplying the time by d and taking the power minus d half. And this puts the correct dimension of p. And then we must have a function which has to be dimensionless. And so the only dimension and constant, it is just, The only dimensional constant is just x squared divided by dt. And so this is the dimensionless ratio. So without knowing the solution of the problem, we just due to a scaling argument, we can predict that the solution must have this form, where f is some suitable function that guarantees, of course, that the probability is also normalized. So in particular, if you set x equals zero, f becomes a constant in that case, and we get the answer that we asked before. The probability to be at the origin at time t scale like t to the minus d half. So in one d, it is minus 1/2, like we were saying before. In the case that we have an external field in the problem, and so meaning that we have an average velocity entering the problem, then we have another time scale through the velocity and the diffusion constant that I showed you before. And so the new time scale is introduced tau, and so this p of t now can have an extra function, an extra dependence on time through a function and the dimensionless ratio, which is f over t. So in the case of the diffusion that I showed before, this function f is an exponential. The scaling argument typically is unable to determine what the small f is, okay? And so you must have some other information on the system in order to calculate it. The only thing that the scaling argument can tell you is about how the scaling function f behaves for small or large argument. So for small argument, meaning when tau is much larger than t, then we want that there is a pure power law scaling, and so the function has to tend to a constant. Otherwise, when t is much larger than tau, we want that this is a truncated power law, and so it goes to zero. Any question at this point? This is just the preamble.
There is no question in the chat, but if anyone wants to ask a question, please either type it or raise hand using the Zoom feature. I think you can move on. I'll tell you if there is any question.
Okay. an important concept that will pervade the rest of this lecture is the basal metabolic rate B. So we are mammals and we are in a thermal engine that we are using energy just through the food, the air that we breathe and so on, and we dissipate energy. And so the dissipated energy is proportional to the energy that we consume. And so this is called the basal metabolic rate that has to be distinguished by what it is called, for example, field metabolic rate, which is what happens when you are running or doing some movement. Whereas the basal one is more or less when you are almost sleeping. For plants, it is the amount of water that is evapotranspirated per day, for example. So a plant of 20 meters height, it can evapotranspirate about 200 liters per day in good condition. And so the amount of water evaporated per day is just a measure of the metabolic rate of a plant. So the metabolic rate, in principle, can depend on many details on the physiology, on the specific physiology of the organism, be an insect, a mammal, a bird, a fish, or whatever, or a plant. So it comes like a surprise that the main trend of the metabolic rate doesn't depend too much on physiological details, apart from some particular case, but it seems to depend mostly on the body mass of the organism, being it a plant or an animal or a bird or whatever. So for example, if we concentrate for a moment in mammals, we dissipate energy through the skin. And so you might think that the dissipated heat then is proportional to the surface area of the skin. Meaning that since we are more or less a compact object, the surface scale like the volume of the organism to the power 2/3, exactly like a sphere as a surface that scale like the radius square and the volume like the radius cube, So it means that the surface of the sphere scale like the volume to the 2/3. So since the mass of a mammal is proportional to the volume through the density of the body, and the density is more or less the one of the water, the mass is proportional to the volume. So it means then that if we take that B is proportional to the surface, the mass is proportional to the volume, and the surface is related to the volume to the power 2/3, we should deduce that the metabolic rate scale like the mass to the 2/3. However, at the end of 40s, 1940s, Mr. Kleiber found that the 2/3 should be 3/4. And indeed, in his original plot, you see the nice picture of Kleiber, Max Kleiber on the right. He was plotting the heat production per day in kilocalories, again in the log plot, as I was teaching you before, versus the log of the mass. So if he's right, he should find that the log of the mass versus the log of the body mass, the log of the metabolic rate versus the log of the body mass should be a straight line of a slope 3/4, which is the red line. And you see that here there are rat, rabbit, dog, woman, I don't know why not men, but it doesn't matter, cow, elephant, whale. This is the whale is just the green point on the top. And the red line has a slope which is 3/4. The upper dashed line, it is just the weight. So if you plot the weight versus the weight, it should be a line with a slope 1. So the upper line has a slope 1. The lower dashed line is the surface. And the surface indeed scale like 2/3. So according to him, the red line is in the middle and it is well approximated by 3/4. Anyway, after 71 here, Brown, the one in the first references on the right bottom, they were calculating again the masses and the metabolic rate corrected with the temperature. Also, there is some temperature correction that has to enter in this law in order to make it a little bit better. You see that the log on it is log of B like before, it is not very visible. It is the log of B versus the log of mass. It doesn't matter if the mass is in gram or in kilograms, because that is just a constant that is added to the log. So it is independent on which unit you are using. The power law does depend on the units. And the log is in base, in natural base. Otherwise, here there are too many order. Anyway, in log 10, it is about 8 in order, 1/8. And the slope is well approximated by 3/4. And here there are, you see plants, mammal, bird, bat, zooplankton, insect, fish. And you see that apart from some local deviation that you can see sometime, but overall, the trend, it is well captured by the 3/4, like I was saying. So one might ask why this 3/4 is important. What is the impact of this law on our life? So this is something that I will, it is again a small problem, but it is done in detail. So the metabolic rate of an organism can be attributed to the maintenance of the cell. So if you have in your body NC cell at time T, each cell is consuming BC as unit of energy. So the metabolic rate, the energy that the input of the energy input in our body, there is a part that is used by cell, and the number of cell is NC. And the part is used to change to the number of cell, meaning doing a new cell, which is the last part. In order to do a new cell, you need EC of energy. So the net balance is that the maintenance più the use for doing a new cell, overall, it is the total input of energy. So the number of cell is proportional to the mass, okay? MC is the mass of the cell. The mass of the cell doesn't change with age. It is the same at all ages. And so we can transform this equation in an equation for M, and using that, the metabolic rate scale with the mass to some power. And we set the constant in such a way that it has the correct unit. So B naught and MC, MC is the mass of the cell. So we scale the mass, M over MC is the number of cells. B naught is some constant in order to fix the right dimension. And alpha can be taken 3/4 if we believe in the Kleiber law. So this equation is transforming this one, where the first term comes from the the second term it is from the maintenance, and the second term, the first term it is from M alpha, it is the Kleiber law, and this is dm over dt. So we get this equation. So if we make a small change of variables and we introduce a dimensionless variable, which is M over capital M, where M, capital M is the adult mass, we can transform the equation for the growth in equation one. And so after we change the variable in terms of dimensionless variables and in terms of a characteristic time, which is this, okay, the red part, we get an equation for X, which is very simple to integrate, and this gives equation three. So then at the end, we find that the mass of an organism should increase like equation four is indicating. Well, you see that, I think that there is a minus sign in the exponential, otherwise it grows to infinity, it's not right. So there is a minus sign in front of the exponent, and there is e to the minus t over tau critical, tau characteristic. And the tau characteristic, it is the mass to the minus one minus alpha. So if alpha is 3/4, it is m to the 1/4. So solving the equation for growth of an organism automatically tells us that there is a characteristic time in our organism that scale like the mass to the 1/4. So not only that, but what we get, it is how the organism should increase their mass as time increases. So if you plot everything in terms of, in terms of time that is scaled in this way, the time is t minus tau characteristic divided by this log, and we take into account the mass at birth. So all organisms plotted the mass of the all organism with respect to the mass of the adult in terms of this rescale time, okay, in this dimensional time, they should collapse in a single curve. So here, for example, we have the fit of how the mass of a cow should grow. Here, how the mass of a guppy should, and you see that the data that are the green light, the green point, I think, the green are the empirical, are well fitted by the curve, by the prediction, both with alpha 2/3 and also with alpha 3/4. The difference is very light. And so each organism has its own ontogenic growth. But if you plot everything in terms of the dimensionless time, this time here that I've written here, and the ratio of the mass, the actual mass divided the mass when they are adult, you see that all curves collapse in a single curve. So you see that here there are points from many animals, pig, shrew, rabbit, cow, rat, and so on, and that they all follow a universal curve. So we are a member of the same family, meaning that we are not too different from a lizard or from a pig in terms of growth, if we choose a suitable scale time and scale mass, meaning we measure the mass with respect to the adult mass, and the time has to be rescaled according to the mass to the 1/4. For example, the lifespan grows like mass to the 1/4. So a small animal, so like a rat, lives much less than an elephant. Also, the heartbeat scale like the mass to the minus 1/4. So as a rabbit has a frequency, a heart frequency, which is much higher than one of an elephant. And so there are many consequences of this, and then you can find them in the original paper by us and by West, Brown, and Engquist. So here now we concentrate on the origin of this one quarter, because there is this m to the one quarter, the metabolic rate scale like the mass to the three quarter, and so it is called quarter power law scaling. Are there questions at this point before I go on?
So not in the chat, but I'm not sure. Yeah, there is a question. Where in this plot? So in this plot, where in this plot fall species in which individual is hard to define? This is uncommon for animals, but very common in plants.
Sorry, what is the question?
I don't know if Miguel wants to ask the question.
Yeah, yes, go ahead. Yes, of course. So here it's fundamental to define an individual, so you can measure mass, the growth of that individual. Yes. So where would the organisms where individual is hard to define, like large prairies of grass where all the grass blades are connected, or
I'm not sure that I understand the question. This individual, I think they are grown in some, all in the same condition, meaning that they are I think they are fed regularly, and the point on this graph, I think it's averages over many individuals of the same kind.
But the definition of the rescaling of the mass depends on the mass of the adult.
Oh, yes, exactly.
The average mass of an adult.
Exactly.
If we have something like in plants, for example, where they can basically continue to grow indefinitely.
That is a question of how to define the mass of a plant. We come back. I think I will come back later to that. You're okay. Right. For plants, one should distinguish between the dead mass and the living mass. You're right.
Okay.
So this here, as you, I don't know if you can read that there is no plants in these plots.
Right.
But you're right. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So now we will concentrate on the possible origin of this quarter power law. And so many years ago, we had some intuition on why or where this three-quarter comes from. And so we were hypothesizing that this could be the result of an optimization principle. And so we said that for a given metabolic rate, evolution has been such that it selected animals or organisms whose mass is the minimum as possible for a given metabolic rate. Or if you want, for a given mass, you want the maximum metabolic rate as possible, which is like to say that if the metabolic rate of a restaurant is the number of meals served per day, and the mass is formed by the number of waiters, you want to have the minimum number of waiters for the given number of meals that you serve every day. So this is, for example, the problem of serving a village or a town with water. And you ask, how much water do we want to have in the pipes that are able to fulfill the need of the town? So if you have pipes that goes around in a way like shown in the figure, like in a spiral, for example, for these nine houses, each house consumes one unit of water per day. So from the main source, we must have that nine unit of water has to leave the main source every day. The pipe enter in the first house, one unit is consumed, out eight units are going out from the first house, and so on. So overall in the pipes you have 8 + 7 + 6, and overall you have that while the metabolic rate is 9, which is 9 units of water per day, the total mass is the total mass present in the pipes. And so if you sum 9 + 8 + 7, what you get, it is approximately L to the 4. If L by L is the size of the town. L square is the metabolic rate, the number of units of water consumed per day, where L to the four is the total water present on the pipes, or the number of waiters that are going around in the tables. And so if you put the two things together, what you have is that the mass scale like the metabolic rate to the square. So we can do better if we, for example, we choose the distribution network is ramified, it is a tree. A directed tree, meaning that the arrow are not going back, but they are only going in the direction away from the source. So again, if you count how much water is in the pipe, instead of the L to the four, you know, you find L to the three. And so the exponent relating the mass to the metabolic rate is 3/2. So it means that in 3D, we get 3/4, because if we do again the same trick as before, what you find is that the metabolic rate scale like the mass to the power D, the dimension of the system, divide D plus one. So in 3D is 3/4. So this seems a very nice a magic theorem that can be proved exactly. not everything is understood perfectly, but at least it gives an idea that this 3/4 might be the result of an optimization principle. For plants, the things is even a little, it is even simpler. So forest, it's for sure, it is one of the most exciting ecosystem because due to their complexity. and the structure of the forest is also related to the forest functionality. By forest structure, I mean the distribution of sizes of tree in a forest. So in the last 40 years, there have been several census of forest around the world. And typically what they do is they measure, which is the easier things, the diameter of the trunk at some height. And then they measure the diameter through this ribbon-like meter. And the distribution of the diameter, the probability to find the fraction of trees with a given diameter is plotted here. This is again a log-log plot. This is the log of individuals, meaning plants, having a given radius, trunk radius at the breast height. So in the horizontal axis you have the log of the diameter. In the vertical axis you have the log of the number of individuals. Of course, these are suitable binned, and you see that more or less in there is one decade, a little bit more than one decade, there is a power law with an exponent which is around -2, and you see that this is true for various kind of forest. Here we are just showing four. Later on, we show more of them. And there is some truncation, meaning that you can find trees with sizes that are too big. you can also measure another trait of the plant beside the trunk radius. You can also measure the volume of the crown. So again, if we plot the log of the crown volume versus the log of the height, okay, we see that there is this cloud of point that more or less stay, there's not been no attempt to make an average and just plot also the error on the average and so on. Just these are the raw data plotting a log-log plot as before. What you see is that the crown volume grows like approximately the cube of the height of the tree. So you might think that you would expect that it is more or less something like a very compact cube and spherical object, but this is not true because I need another slide. You can define an exponent that says in principle how the crown radius scale with the height of the tree. And so this is typically described by an exponent that is called the Hurst exponent. So this Hurst exponent for this slide, it is one, as I will show in a moment, but before showing that, Let me show what happens at various latitudes. This exponent that around the tropics is around one, as you go toward the more northern latitude, it decay toward 0.5. Okay, so it's not true that plants are always like spherical object, like in this picture. But as you go to more to the north, they become shorter in height, but also much thinner. So here at the tropics, it is almost an isotropic scaling of the width and the height. Whereas as you move to the northern, the height scale much faster than the width of the crown. This does mean that they are taller. Indeed, they are shorter in height, but the width of the crown scale with an exponent which is smaller than one. So now let's see what are the impact of this scaling, before that we can derive how the metabolic rate of a plant scale with the plant mass, and so we can come to what is meant by mass of a plant, at least for me. So we have that plants are taking water from underground and through xylems that are not cylindrical but almost cylindrical conduit, they are transported to the leaves, and through stoma they are evapotranspirated in the air. And so if the leaf density on the crown is more or less constant, and if the leaves is an invariant unit, meaning that they are not changing with the age of the tree, which is true. If I give you a leaf of a tree, you can't say if the tree is 1 year old or 100 or 1,000 year old. It is always the same. Based on that, if the tree volume, if the crown scale like the height to the capital H, then you can calculate what is the volume of the crown. So it is H times H to the power H, sorry, the R crown square, which means H to the 2A capital H, meaning that the crown volume scale like the height of the tree to an exponent, which is 1 plus 2H. So as I said before, the capital H is about one around the tropics. And so it makes the crown the volume crown to scale like more or less 3 around the tropics. And then at the most northern latitude, it scale like 2, because H, capital H, becomes about 1/2. So we go from H cubed near the tropics to H squared to the north. And if the leaf density is more or less constant, we can deduce, since the evapotranspiration is proportional to the surface of the leaves, the number of leaves is proportional to the volume, so we have that the metabolic rate of the tree is related to the volume of the crown, which is the height of the tree to the power 1 plus 2h, capital H. Now you can also measure the mass of the water inside the tree, okay? And the mass of the water inside the tree is proportional to what is called the sapwood, the living part of the wood, which is just the external part of the trunk. Meaning the water is flowing only through the external part of the trunk. This is not strictly true for all plants. For example, at the tropics, all the wood is more or less living, and so all trunk is conducting water. Whereas where there is the seasons at our latitude is only the external part that is more conductive, the internal one is dead. And so we have the water is flowing only near the surface of the trunk. And so what we mean by mass of a tree is the water present in the tree, or if you want, the living wood, not the dead part. So you can do a simple calculation to see that the amount of water present, it is the metabolic rate times age. Just calculating how much water is contained in the xylem, given that the surface of the tip of the xylem can be identified with the stoma of the leaf, which we have already calculated the surface. And so you can calculate that the total mass, the total water present on a plant is proportional to height of the tree to the power 2+2h. So if we use that B is proportional to H to the 1+2H, and the mass is as an extra power of H, you can put everything together and you find the generalization of the Kleiber's law in terms of the Haast exponent. And so you see that when capital H is one, you find the 3/4. So for plants near the tropics, we should have that the metabolic rate scale like the living part of the wood or the total water present in the plants to the power 3/4. Whereas away from the tropics, this exponent becomes smaller till it reaches 2/3 toward the north. So you can also express the metabolic rate if all the cross section of the trunk transport water, or a fraction of it at least, then we can also express the metabolic rate as the water flow times the cross section, which is approximately pi r square. And the water density, of course, does depend on the size of the tree. At the end, what you find is the metabolic rate is also proportional to the cross section of the trunk at the base. Okay? So if we use that, at the end, you can get this nice table where you can express the metabolic rate as the height to the 1+2H or to r square. Or if you use these two relations, you can express the radius of the trunk in terms of the height of the tree. So you see that when h is one, you get that the radius of the trunk grows like superlinearly with the height. You might observe that the trunk radius is much smaller than the height of the tree. That is true. I'm not saying the opposite, but it means that here in front there must be an amplitude that is very small. So the amplitude is not the concern of the scaling theory, at least at this level, but it is an important issue because that is related to what is the maximum height of a tree, okay? Because we don't see trees that are half a kilometer height, but mostly are 100 meter height, and that is an open issue. Nobody knows why trees stop to grow in height, but they can grow in mass, as one of your colleagues was saying before. The mass of a tree is always growing because there is a part that is dead, that is it is just it's just the physical support of the plant. The radius of the crown scale like in this way, okay, just using the scaling of H and R, the mass of a tree, if it is more or less concentrated on trunk and branch scale like H times R square, meaning the more or less the mass of the trunk. And so you can find that the mass of a tree scale like at the tropics scale like H to the 4. So the volume scale like H cube, as I said before, the mass scale like H to the 4. So then it means that the density of the wood scale like H cube, sorry, H4 divide H cube, meaning that the density of the wood of a plant grows like H. So you can imagine that this density cannot grow forever because at a certain point, branches started to collapse one on the other and there's no more room for leaves. So there's no more room for evapotranspiration. So this constraint is telling you that at a certain point, it must stop. Okay, in order to evaluate the where this can occur, we should know what are the constants in front of this power law. That has to be there also for dimensional reason. So now we can also use this geometrical traits to understand what happens for an assembly of plant or for, let's say, for forest. Any question at this point?
There are not questions in the chat.
Let's go on.
I think we can go on and then collect questions at the end.
Okay. There is a question?
Yeah, perhaps there is a question. Sabina?
Yeah, I have a question. This is very interesting. I would like to ask, you showed before that there is this paper that they have found that the relationship of the body mass with the number of the individuals, they found the scaling exponent of -2.
Oh, yes. Around -2, yes. The number of individuals of plant with a given radius, trunk radius, scale like r to the -2.
Yeah, my question is based on, because there is also the Damoth's rule, which
is also the
Damoth's rule, who also
Damoth's law, okay?
Damoth's law, yeah, that he also predicts that the relationship of the body size and the abundance should scale with the -3/4.
Yes, yeah, that is another problem. Damoth was one of, we have collaborated, so I know what he was meant. So if you take if you are interested in cultivating trees and you want to know how many trees can stay on a given area, but trees of the same size, then you are right, because if each tree that they have all the same size, so they are all consuming the same amount of energy, and we know that each of them is consuming r square, okay? So you have to take the maximum number of trees of the same size times r square, which is the size, has to be equal to the amount of resources that are available. So if the amount of resources that are available is fixed, the total number of trees is r to the -2, exactly. But this exponent is related, what you are saying is related to trees that are more or less of the same size. I'm not talking of that. We are talking of the distribution of sizes, like it is observing forests like this. I will come back to that problem in a moment.
Okay.
So in order to understand exactly this problem, how the sizes of trees are distributed on a forest, we must introduce another optimization principle, which is that we assume that plants are trying to fill all possible room that is free. Of course, a fraction of it, a finite fraction, is not just an infinitesimal fraction, but a fraction of it. So if we assume that, we must have that at any given height, we must have that the room, that the space is occupied by leaves. So if we say that the probability to have plants of a given height, P naught of H, the P naught is introduced because I want to call it ideal distribution, we know that the volume of a crown scale like small h to the power 1 + 2H. The distribution of height is P naught of H. So the total number of trees, suppose that is capital N, okay? So N times P naught of H prime times DH prime is, it is just the fourth line. It is the total number of trees with height in the range between H and H plus DH. If we multiply this by the volume, which is H prime to the power 1 + 2H, and we integrate between zero and capital N, the small h, we require that this is proportional to the volume of the forest of area A, meaning this is it is filling almost uniformly all the room at disposal. And so we are saying that the total volume occupied by the leaves is proportional to A, the area of the forest, times H. This has to be true for all H in the range between, let's say, zero and some maximum height that I've called H critical. If I differentiate with respect to H, then what you derive from here is that the ideal distribution, it is some constant, the area of the plot divided by N, which is the inverse density of plants, times H to the power -1 + 2H. The density of trees, this picture is taken from the book by Hubble, The Neutral Theory biogeography, and you see that the density is constant. The density of plants as the number as the plant as the plot area increases, you see that there is a perfect straight line with slope one, and so it means that this is just constant. And so it is just the ideal distribution of height, it is just h to the exponent of the crown volume. So now we take into account that there is a constraint that the plot has to satisfy, that the resource availability is fixed. So if we take into account the resource availability, the ideal distribution has to be modified by taking into account that we cannot have as many plants as we want. So if we take into account the limitation in the resource availability, we find that after we change the variable from height to radius of the trunk, we find that the distribution at the tropics, just for simplicity, it is r to the minus 7 over 3, and then the truncated power law with some characteristic radius that is related to the availability of the resources. So the minus 7 over 3 is just the ideal distribution without taking into account the finiteness of the resources. Sorry, this is my dog. And so the exponent is not a minus 2, like a simple application of Damm's law is true, but it's not answering to this question of the distribution of the sizes. So the exponent is 2.3. And indeed, from the data, we saw that the exponent is nearer to 7 over 3 than 2. Originally, West, Enquist, and Brown did a mistake, and they were saying that this was minus 2, and they also related to it to Damm's law, but it's not the Damm's law. Of course, as we go up in the latitude, this exponent changes. So in order to understand why the finiteness of the resource availability impact on the ideal distribution, one has to use a minimum principle. So we say that the true distribution with this P of H has to be as near as possible to the ideal one, taking into account that the total amount of resources has to be finite. So if we impose that the total number of resources has to be finite, and this is equation two, and we want to minimize the distance of the real distribution from the ideal one, after some calculation, we find that the distribution of height is the ideal one, which is the red here, times the exponential. So if we now do a change of variables with some assumption that we know that the radius of the trunk scale like the height of the tree in this way, we saw this in the table that I was showing before. So if we do this, if this is a deterministic, meaning that given the radius of the trunk, we automatically say what is the height of the tree, then we should say that it is a delta of Dirac. This is not true because there are two random variables. So in principle, what we have to see is that the probability that we have a given radius of the trunk, given that the height of the tree is h, a generalization of a delta of Dirac is this scaling ansatz. So if we use this scaling ansatz with the distribution of the height, the non-ideal one that we have just found in the previous slide that you can go over carefully by yourself, we use what we found in the previous slide. We use this scaling ansatz, which is the number two, which is a generalization of a deterministic ansatz. And then you do some calculation, you find what is the distribution of the radius, which is this power law, 1 plus 6 capital H divided 1 plus 2 H. When capital H is 1, you find 7 over 3, corrected by this exponential, which is a Gaussian in this case, which is R divided R over RC. RC is just related to the amount of resources that are at disposal. So if the resources are very, very large, RC is very large, and so the exponential comes into play only for large radius, and you can see a beautiful power law. On the other hand, if the resources are very tiny, then RC is very small, and so the power law is masked by this correction here. So we take this is a constant, by the way. It is just can be fixed by normalization. So if we take the distribution for granted and we just have only one parameter in our problem, which is RC, because we don't have a measure of the source avoidability, and we measure capital H from the crown geometry, then we plug it there and we can make prediction on the distribution of radius of trunk in various forests around the world. This is just a sample of 9. We have about 50 of them. So the red point are the prediction based on the previous slide. We just fitting just one parameter, which is RC, and the black dots are the data. And you see that the agreement with the data is quite satisfactory. The data are not perfect because there are census. The census are done every 5 years. The statistic is good, but it's not exceptional. And so you can find anyway that it is quite reasonable. So I think that I should finish. Let me just finish. These are just a problem for you. Okay, these are two problems for you. This I can skip. And based on the ideal distribution that I saw, that I was showing, this ideal distribution, you can go to forest and measure how far you are from the ideal distribution, from the prediction, let's say. So if we have a forest where there is some disturbance, like a road or something that is going on some part, nearer you are to the disturbance, which is part B. If you go and measure the distribution of sizes in part B and in part A, part A is undisturbed if it's far away, and the dashed green line, it is the prediction, and the black line, it is the data. And you see that the prediction agree with the data. On the other hand, given that the crown radius is not disturbed by the presence of the road, we can measure the crown radius. We can measure the capital H exponent. We can predict what is the power law of the ideal distribution. And if we compare the ideal prediction, which is the dashed line for both A and B, the dashed line is the prediction. You see that in B, the distribution of trees differ from the ideal one. Whereas in A, which is far away from the disturbance, agree with the prediction. So the scaling approach can quantify the degrees of disturbance in a forest just going and measuring the distribution of sizes. The distribution of sizes deviated from the prediction. Based on that, you can say how wealth is a forest. And so you can quantify the degrees of wellness. So this is a graph, again, for various forests. And the measurement was done by Silan, one of our collaborators. And you see that when you are far away from the disturbance, the dashed line is the ideal. And as you move toward the high disturbance, you see that the disturbance is quite visible. And you see a large deviation from the ideal one. So this is just a cartoon. So these are the main conclusions. So thank you for your attention, and sorry, I'm almost at the end of the hour.
Thank you, Amos, for the very nice lecture. So if you have a question, please raise your hand. So in the meanwhile, there is a question actually from the chat by Jordi, who is asking a clarification on the Hurst exponent. So is the its value obtained experimentally, or there are any physical arguments or biological arguments for its value dependence on the latitude?
On the latitude?
Yes, so...
Yeah, that is our problem. This is what we haven't understood. There is some echo that I feel. So the capital H, how it changing with latitude, is an open problem, and in the beginning, Enquist and Niklas was saying that forests away from tropics are exceptional, meaning that they are exception to the power law with an ideal exponent, let's say 3 for the crown volume, whereas we are saying that they are obeying a different scaling. And but we haven't, we are not able to present an argument to see how the exponent capital H changes with latitude. It's just an empirical observation based on data.
Great. If there is any other question, please, this is the time to ask. Okay. Everything was here. So the lecture will be available on YouTube. And there is a question by Martina. How do you measure RC?
Can you repeat?
How do you measure RC?
Which RC is a fit parameter. We have to fit the data because RC, I said, is related to the where the truncation of power law occur. And in the derivation that I did, I was relating RC to the amount of available resources. So if the resources, the available resources are a huge, RC becomes very high. Otherwise, if the resources are very tiny, RC becomes very small. But since we don't have access to the available resources, we have to fit this parameter.
Great. So there is another question from YouTube, actually, asking, can you apply the same scaling concept to other communities that are not plant communities?
Yes. Forest is an easy community because the plants are not moving and you can measure sizes very easy, but we don't have such a facility for other communities, but we are trying to do it for bacteria's community. I think that Rinaldo, I don't know which lecture he has done, but we were doing measurement of bacteria's and we are seeing similar things also for bacteria's, but with not as a good statistics as we have for forests. But surely it's something that should be done in the future at the same level of accuracy.
Great. So thank you, Amos, very much again for giving this lecture. And now we are going to